Hello. Today we're going to be talking about gases. And when you think of a gas, right, you should think about the air all around us. Obviously, that's made up of gas. And you can take a nice deep breath and, you know, gases come in, they go out, they fill up space, right? If I take a balloon, I fill it up, that gas fills up the space. And what we're going to do is we're going to quantify all this stuff. We're going to actually try to do some math to figure it out. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, let's say you wanted to put someone on a ventilator. Well, if you wanted to put someone on a ventilator, you better know a lot about how gases work and how pressure works and how volume of the lungs changes with pressure and how to deliver just the right amount of oxygen and not too much of the other things. And you really need to understand those things if you're going to be doing respiration work or any other things that involve gases. Or if you go scuba diving, it's important to know a little bit about gases as well. So these things do have their uses, and obviously that's not everything, but that's just a start to it. So the first thing we have to figure out is what defines a gas? When we think about a gas, what are the different parts of it that allow us to say, oh, I've got this going on versus that going on? Well, if we think about filling up a balloon, right? One of the first things we think about is how big is the balloon? And so certainly volume is one of the primary variables that define a gas. Now in volume, generally in gases, we're going to measure things in units of liters, but we certainly could measure it in other units, milliliters, gallons, or whatever. But by far the most common unit we're going to use is liters. And, you know, if I take this little water bottle right here, it is a 500 milliliter water bottle. So if I close it up, what it means is there's 500 milliliters of gas inside of there. So that's our volume. So what else? Well, if we think of, I don't know, the weather. When you think of the weather, they might measure a barometer and they talk about the pressure and whether it's a low pressure or high pressure thing. And so that's another important variable inside or when talking about a gas. Now, pressure, there's a bunch of different units, so we're going to talk about those in just a minute. But the most common is the unit called an atmosphere, which people abbreviate as an ATM. Not those places where you go and just gives you money, but just an atmosphere, short for atmosphere. So volume and pressure. Another thing I might want to know is how much gas do I have? Do I have a lot of gas or a little bit of gas? And generally, when we talk about how much gas we have, we talk about how many moles of gas. We could talk about the mass of the gas, how many grams or kilograms, but then it turns out we'd have to convert that to moles anyway to do anything with it. So most people just talk about how many moles of gas we have. And it's usually abbreviated with a lowercase n when we're talking about gases. And so you'll see that in some of our equations. Volume, pressure, moles, well, nothing. How hot is it? Is the gas really hot? Are we talking about, you know, a superheated gas? We're talking about a really, really cold gas. Well, can you have really cold gas? Yeah, helium is still a gas at like minus 200 degrees Celsius. So yes, you can have very, very cold gases. So temperature is the other variable that we worry about. Now, normally we've talked about temperature in degrees Celsius as our most common unit, but we cannot use that for gases, and we'll see why in a little bit why. But we have to use the unit of Kelvin. And you remember, if you want to get the temperature in Kelvin, you just take the temperature in Celsius and you add yourself 273 to get that conversion there. Alrighty, so again, let's talk a little bit about the pressure units, because I said there's a few different ones that we talk about. But first, I want to really talk about what is pressure. Right? Is pressure just what you feel when you've got three exams scheduled on the same day? You feel a lot of pressure for something like that? Or is there something else to it, right? And if we talk about pressure, is there pressure around us? I said we measure these things in atmospheres, but how do we know that there's pressure all around us? Well, turns out pressure has a very precise type of definition, a formula, in fact. And pressure is just force. Now, what is force? It's like, kind of like a weight. So if you have a weight and it's pulled down by gravity, that weight is exerting a force downward. And if it's sitting on a table, you know, if you've done physics, there's a force upward as well, but we won't worry about that. So force is just kind of like a push or a pull, and it's divided by area. So I could take something really heavy like this box, right? And I could balance this box on my hand just fine. It's not a problem to balance this box on my hand, doesn't hurt at all. Even though it's a little heavy, I think there's a book in here or something like that. But if I take that same box and I take, well, I don't have one in front of me, but if I take a sharp pencil, and this thing's not too dull, and I take that sharp pencil and I put that sharp pencil on my hand, and I put the exact same box on the top of my sharp pencil and allow that to sit on my hand right there, and I'm not even letting it rest right there, and it already hurts. It's the same box, right? There's no difference. I didn't change the box on you. But what changed in there? And what changed is not the force, because the force was from the box. What changed is the area. As my area went down, as my denominator got smaller and smaller, my pressure went up, 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 and up. And all of a sudden, even though I had the same box, I now have this like dent in my finger from the same box pushing on one little tiny spot on my finger because the pressure was so huge. Now it turns out we actually use that in real life. If you've ever gone ice skating, it turns out when you go ice skating, you don't go ice skating, you go water skating because you have a very, very sharp blade on your ice skate. And as you go across the water, that very, very sharp blade with this very small area puts a huge pressure on the ice and actually melts it. And so as you go across with a very sharp blade, you're actually melting the ice as you go across. And then as your blade leaves, there's no pressure anymore, and it freezes again, which is really cool. So you can go ice skating, but you're actually going water skating. If you tried that on dry ice, you guys have probably seen that at the store, it's CO2 in ice form, it wouldn't work. You'd actually just sit there and kind of jerk along because CO2 doesn't melt when it puts pressure on. So that's a kind of a neat thing. So pressure is force divided by area. Now, how do I know that there's pressure all around me? I mean, I don't feel like there's a lot of pressure on me right now, but it turns out there is. There's a lot of pressure on me right now. There is 14.7 pounds per square inch, or PSI. You might have heard of that unit before when you're trying to fill up a bike tire or something like that. Pounds per square inch, 14.7. So if I just take a square inch on my arm right here, there's 14.7 pounds on there. Well, the next square inch, there's not. And if, you know, imagine if there was that much weight on my arm, I wouldn't be able to lift my arm. So how can I lift my arm so easily? Well, it's because underneath there's also the exact same amount pushing up as there is pushing down. And so it's relatively easy to move my arm because the pressure is balanced. And you're like, no, there can't be that much pressure just around us. I mean, that's a ridiculous amount of pressure if you think about it. I mean, there's a lot of square inches on my body. I'd just be crushed by all that pressure. Well, I can prove to you that there's pressure around you with this lovely little water bottle right here. What is in this water bottle, right? It's open, which means there's air in this water bottle. And this water bottle looks pretty stable to me. It doesn't look like it's crushing or doing anything like that. And why is that? It's because there's air on the inside pushing out, and there's also air on the outside pushing in. But what if I were to take the air on the inside out? Right? If I were to use a vacuum and suck all the air out, what would happen? Well, we kind of know, but let's look at it and watch. And see, now you can see that the bottle crushed a lot. And if I fill it back up with air, I can get it to uncrush. Now, why did it crush? Well, you're saying, Professor Gomez, because there was no air inside, and so it crushed because it was pulled, because you pulled the air out. Well, if there's no air inside, can it pull? Can the lack of something pull? No, if there's no air inside, there's nothing pulling, right? So what caused it to crush is the air on the outside pushing on it. So as I took the air from the inside of the bottle, all this air that was on the outside, it used to have air on the inside pushing back on it. But when I took all that out, all of a sudden it went, and it crushed because there was lots of pressure, 14.7 pounds per square inch on the outside and nothing on the inside. Okay, so now we know there is pressure around us, 14.7 pounds per square inch, which we get is about 1 atmosphere of pressure. Again, often abbreviated ATM. Now there's another very common unit that you're gonna see a lot, and it's named after a scientist whose name was Torricelli. And so we call it the torr, and it's 760 torr is 1 atmosphere. And this is a definition, so it's exact. So when you use that as a conversion factor, you won't be having to do anything like trying to figure out significant figures from that conversion factor. You're just gonna have to do significant figures from your starting number. One other conversion that we're gonna run across, not too often in this class, but you might see it occasionally, is that there are 101,325 pascals in 1 atmosphere. Again, you don't have to worry about that one, but I just wanna point that out to you that it exists in case you ever run across it. The one we're gonna use primarily in this class is both torr and atmosphere, both of which are very commonly used in chemistry. These ones, pounds per square inch, is often used in the US, but not too much here. So, you know, we might do one or two conversions with it on the homework, but we won't see it too much beyond that. So let's practice doing a conversion with torr. And let's say we want to convert 720 torr into atmospheres. And just like every other conversion in this class, what are we going to do? We're going to put our starting material over here. We're going to put our desired unit over here. We're going to say we think there's a conversion factor that gets us from one to the other. What goes on the bottom? Well, torr is on the top, which means torr has to go on the bottom so they can cancel out. What goes on the top? We want ATM, so ATM has to go on the top. And what numbers do we put in? Again, don't memorize 760 goes on top, 760 goes on bottom. That'll get you in trouble. Memorize that numbers are attached to their unit. 760 is attached to torr, so wherever torr is, 760 is. And we got one atmosphere. And if you do that math, you get 0.95 atmospheres. I had two significant figures in my starting number. I have two significant figures in my ending number because my conversion factor was exact, so it's not going to change anything. So that's how we do conversion between atmospheres and torrs. And you should definitely know how to do that because we're going to see that in problems. Sometimes I might give you pressure in atmosphere, pressure in torrs, and you're going to need to convert between them to be able to work with them. All right, so those are our pressure and pressure, volume, and temperature units that we most commonly use. Okay, so I actually already did that slide. I was a little bit ahead. So I want you to try this one out. The pressure in a system was measured to be 1,270 torr, and I want to know what is that pressure in atmospheres. Okay. No, try it, like really, pause, try it. Come on, pause, try it. Okay, well, I tried. What are we gonna do? We're gonna set it up like every other conversion in this class. Torr over here, we want atmospheres over here. We're gonna put atmospheres on top so we get atmospheres. We're gonna put torr on the bottom so we get rid of torr, 760 torr in one atmosphere. If you do that math out, I get my little handy dandy calculator and I say it is 1270 divided by 760, I get 1.67105 ATM. What are my significant figures? I've got three significant figures over here, which means I can get three significant figures over here, and I've got 1.67 ATM, which is answer C. All right, that's how we do those conversions between torr and atmosphere. So that's kind of just a simple introduction to gases, and what we're going to talk about next is how can we relate all these different variables? How is pressure related to volume, or volume to moles and things like that? And those things are called the gas laws. Thanks.